Good evening, Central. Hallelujah. I'm so glad you're here. Isn't God good? Amen. So the youth are going to be leading us tonight. They're going to stay in here. There's a lot of strep going around, right? So I want to help you. Two things we're going to do. Number one, we're going to lay hands on you and pray. Number two, I'm going to tell you, you need to take vitamin C, vitamin D, zinc, right? Let's get your immune system boosted up, you know, and pray without ceasing. Amen. So we got, there's a lot of folks that need prayer, but I tell you, I want us to start off here tonight. Let's just stand to our feet and let's lift our hands to heaven. Let's love on Jesus. Amen. Lord, I love you and I thank you and I praise you for all that you're doing. Master, I pray, first of all, Lord, that from the north, south, east, west, every corner of this property, that, Lord, you will set your angels and give them charge over this house, this people, that, Father God, you keep us from any sickness, no disease, Lord, can come this way. We lift up Lord Anthony and Amy, and we lift up, Lord, just so many here tonight, Lord, that they've got strep or they've got this or they got that. But Father God, I thank you that, Lord, you brought us here for such a time. And Lord, that means we don't have time to be sick. So in the name of Jesus, Lord, send your word of healing. Lord, bring healing and deliverance to every life. I speak life in Jesus' name to every person, everybody. Lord, just bless in this service. Lord, just come and meet with us tonight. Here's my prayer in Jesus' name. And everybody said a great big loud amen. Amen. God bless you. Go ahead, guys. Let's give them a hand as they start.
Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Thank you. Lay down my Glory.
Just love on him tonight. Just bless him. Hallelujah. Exalt thee. Lord, we lift you up. We bless the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Come on, just lift Jesus higher. Lift him up tonight. Exalt thee. We bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You just in your own way tell him thank you. Come on, just begin to give him thanks. Thank him for your own health. Thank him for your family. Thank him for the church family that he's put you in. Come on, just give him praise. Lord, I thank you, Father God, for the house, the roof over our heads, Lord, for the vehicles we drive, for the, Lord, the good jobs you've given us. Lord, we thank you that we live in a nation, Lord, where we can worship you freely. Father God, we've got so much to be thankful for here today. I bless you, Lord. I don't want to take for granted the things you've given me. You're a good, good Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're a good Father. You're Abba. Abba. Thank you. Abba, Father. Hallelujah. That's good. Amen, 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 amen. Come on, give him a hand clap of praise. He's worthy. Thank you, youth. Glory to God. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you for taking us there. Praise God. Hallelujah. We're going to be in Galatians chapter 4 tonight, so you can turn in your Bibles there, Galatians chapter 4. On Wednesday nights when I'm preaching, I'm trying to just go through this book. It's really foundational for your faith, right? Now, you know, Christians, let me just talk to the church tonight. You guys are guilty of speaking another language. And I ain't talking about tongues right now. It's Christianese, right? We get up here and we use phrases and descriptions, and we expect, you know, everybody to understand it. Well, look, if you weren't raised in this stuff, you hadn't been around it a long time, you don't understand. When we say Abba, then people look at you, was he talking in tongues? What is that, right? Yeah. Well, that's a Bible word. It's a Greek word, meaning, you know, it's an intimate relationship with Father. We would say Daddy, right, you know, or you, maybe you say Papa to your dad, whatever. You know, it's Abba. It's a term of endearment and fellowship, right? And you know, so that's one of the words you're going to hear tonight. You know, you're going to hear the word slave, and you got to understand in the Greek, in this particular context, the Greek word is doulos, and it's not a slave that has been, you know, bought from another country or conquered territory. It's somebody it's someone that has sold themselves into slavery. They're like, you know, they get in trouble financially and they sell themselves, right? And so their needs are taken care of until they're able to pay their debt off, right? It's a willing participant in the economy of another. And so when we talk about servants of God or deacons, a deacon is another, it's doulos. It's someone that we don't have, we choose not to exercise our personal rights anymore. Come on. I'm living the life of another. I've given my life to Jesus, and so I'm a slave for Christ. Paul will say that several times in his books. I'm a slave for Jesus, right? My rights I gave over to him. And so as Christians, we just kind of read through this and we spout this stuff off. But folks, we've got to understand that foundationally, to understand, you know, the relationship that the believer has with Almighty God is a very peculiar one. Now, the Bible and the biblical writers use things that are in the earth to try to point to some of these spiritual truths. And sometimes Paul or whoever's writing has to come back and kind of unpack that a little bit, right? To help people understand really what happened to you when you got born again, when you were saved, when you committed your life to Christ. What really happened? Amen? So tonight we're gonna kind of get in these verses and we're gonna allow the Word of God to kind of help us to understand what this relationship with Jesus really is all about. Will you pray? Let me read it and then we'll pray. And actually, I want to back up to chapter 3, verse 24, and then we'll come through 4, verse 7. Galatians chapter 3, verse 24. I'm in the New Living Translation tonight, guys. I'm kind of threw you a curve there. Let me put it another way. The law, now he's talking about the law of Moses, was our guardian until Christ came. It protected us until we could be made right with God through faith. And now that the way of faith has come, we no longer need the law as our guardian. For you are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ like putting on new clothes. I like that translation right there. Amen. How many of you have put on Christ? I mean, people look at you, it's like, you changed clothes. There's something different about you, right? Amen. There is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Now, folks, that's the answer. The solution to the division in our culture today is Jesus. Come on. There's neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free, male nor female. Amen. There's not Republican or Democrat. There's... I'm just going to mess with some of you conservative folks, you know, you weirdos, race baiters, you know, just whatever you got, whatever your deal is, get over yourself. If you're going to have an identity, let your identity be in him. Come on. You know, now you might have some particularly strong opinions and strong beliefs. Amen. Let other people tag you how they will. I've been called all kinds of weird stuff. Amen. But I'm a man of God. I'm a person. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. And that's my identity. And that's how I want people to know me. Amen. So the apostle is saying, you're all one, how? In Christ Jesus. Now that you belong to Christ, you are the true children of Abraham. You are his heirs, and God's promise to Abraham belongs to you. Chapter 4, verse 1. Think of it this way. If a father dies and leaves an inheritance for his young children, those children are not much better off than slaves, doulos, right? Children are not slaves, right? But it's the relationship is such that they can't exercise their own will. You know, in my house, my kids, they exercise their will once or twice. before I let the hammer down, right? Come on, this is my house, amen, my rules. You don't like it, go get your own house and you can build your own rules. come on, mom, dad, shout me down here. So he said, the children are not much better off than slaves until they grow up, even though they actually own everything their father had, right? So what he's saying is if a, and I read it, reading a commentary, so it was, who did they say? Let's say, let me just pick a one modern one that everybody understands. Bill Gates, right? Bill Gates has a, you know, little 10, 12-year-old son. Bill Gates dies, and in his will, everything goes to his son. Well, his son can't take that money and go spend it yet. He's got to come of age before he can possess it. Even though he owns it, he doesn't. He can't act on that ownership, right? And so the Apostle Paul is going to use this concept of an heir, amen. It all belongs to him, but he can't act on what he's got just yet, right? That's the point he's trying to make here, that those children are not much better off than slaves until they grow up, even though they actually own everything their father had. They have to obey their guardians until they reach whatever age their father set. And that's the way it was with us before Christ came. We were like children. We were slaves to the basic spiritual principles of this world. But when the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent him to buy freedom for us who were slaves to the law, so that he could adopt us as his very own children. And because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, prompting us to call out, not God, not the big man upstairs, come on, but Abba. Amen. What'd you call your daddy that was different? Huh? Daddy? Papa? Come on. Okay, who said old man? I'll knock you out. Abuelo? We got any abuelos in here? Nobody used abuelo? That's grandpa. I'm sorry. That's right. So that's why they call me abuelo. Yeah, I got that figured out. So it's a term of endearment, right? You know, my girls called me, daddy when they were little, and that was special to me. And I think it was Tiffany. She come up, we moved down here to Houston, and, you know, she gets in this big high school, 1,000 freshmen, right? And she comes home and called me dad. Dad. Don't you call me dad? Why? It means the same thing. No, it doesn't. Daddy is this sweet, intimate. Dad is like, it's a position. Do you see the difference? And when the Spirit of God, listen to me, this is the point Paul is making. When the Holy Spirit comes into your heart, he brings this relationship between the big man upstairs and you down to the place to where you don't call him dad, but he's daddy. He's Abba. Oh, I love that thought. I want you to become so intimate with Christ that your relationship is just like that. And you can, listen, you can tell people's relationship with God by how they refer to him. You know, how do you talk about him? Amen. You know, man, the Lord's been so good to me. I was fellowshipping with him this morning, right? Okay, you're good. Yeah. Well, I prayed to my Heavenly Father last night. Okay, that's nice. Dad. Right? You know, that there ought to be. Now, you know, it's that sure there's a ditch on both sides of this thing, right? You know, you don't want to become so familiar that you just kind of abuse the relationship. But you know what? As a father, I was really good about making sure my kids knew I loved them and we would have this little cool relationship, but don't cross the line. Right. And I believe Abba is the same way. I believe our Heavenly Father, He'll help us keep it straight, right? All right. I don't want to belabor that point. what verse was I on? 6. There you go. Because we're His children, God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, prompting us. Amen. The Holy Spirit's prompting us to call out, Abba, Father. Now you are no longer a slave, a doulos, but you are God's own child. And since you were His child, God has made you His heir. Amen. Father, thank you for the reading of your word. I pray that the blessing of obedience would be ours. I pray, Father, that you would reveal to us, Lord, what you desire for each one of us sitting in this room. That, Lord, there are inheritances, there are gifts, and there are callings, and there are special relationships and intimate moments you want to have with everyone in this room individually. I thank you for the corporate worship that we can have here tonight. But God, there is an intimacy you want to have with us as individuals, and I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you bring us in to that kind of understanding. It's my prayer tonight in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. I want to talk to you just a little while tonight about you know, what Jesus really brought for us. Amen. And the Paul will refer to it, and really the easiest thing to understand is He brought us freedom. Amen. And how many of you know as Americans, freedom's not free. Right? You know, freedom comes at a cost. There are three things I want to talk about. Number one, freedom comes at a price. Number two, freedom's got to be maintained. And number three, sometimes we have to renew that relationship. Amen. We have to renew that freedom. All right. So the Apostle Paul, he says here, think of it this way. If a father dies and leaves an inheritance, first of all, I want you to understand that what Jesus did on the cross was more than just pay for your sin. Amen. So you could be forgiven. Now, I get it. When you first come to Christ, all I wanted was that monkey off my back. I wanted to get the conviction done. I wanted to feel clean. I was tired of feeling dirty and confused. Come on. Am I talking to anybody? I was tired of that, and I just wanted to be forgiven, and I wanted the peace of knowing that I was forgiven. Amen? That's beautiful. But what, you know, the way we talk here and we teach here, 1 John 1:9, and put 1 John 1:9 up there, guys, if you will. 1 John 1:9 is very, very clear that God wants to do more than just forgive you. Amen? Because if all you get is forgiveness, you walk away forgiven and clean, amen, you're free from that, but you haven't been changed. Amen. You know, when people come to this country as visitors, you know, they'll get a temporary visa, they'll come over here, and they can enjoy all of the freedoms we have. You know, people from China will come here on a work visa or an educational visa, and they get to enjoy every bit of the freedom that you and I have. But one day they got to go back home. And when they go back home, that freedom doesn't follow them. Come on. But as a child of America, as a citizen of the United States, I get to enjoy that freedom. But it didn't come for free. It was costly. Amen. And that's the importance of this verse. If we confess our sins to Him, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. There's an and there, right? The freedom doesn't come from just forgiveness. The freedom comes from cleansing. From when He, you know, Brother Clendenin tells a story that he was talking to one of these big guys on TV, you know, and because he traveled in those circles for a little while. He had a huge TV program, and so he'd get invited to these Christian TV programs. And so he's on there, and him and one of these hyper-faith guys are having this conversation. And this hyper-faith guy looks at him and says, "My faith got me an airplane. What'd your faith get you?" And Brother Clendenin said, "My faith delivered me from the vanity of ever wanting one of those things." Come on. Amen. It's not just about using God to get what you want. It's about coming to Him so that He can change me and get rid of the vanities and the issues. Amen. You walk in here drunk, you can walk out of here sober and free from now on. Amen. That is the power of the gospel to change your life. But it's not free. It came at the expense of the blood of Jesus. It's very costly, and we've got to understand that. Amen. When we come to Christ, He comes. He gave His life, but it was for more than just so He could wipe His hand across the room and say, "You're forgiven." He wants to come inside of you. Now, we can go back to the tabernacle and the temple, and we can see that, you know, in the Old Testament, Israel's approach to God was very structured and very limited. Right? Only certain people could come in and offer sacrifice, number one. Only certain people could offer that sacrifice and take the blood into the Holy of Holies. Only the high priest, amen, once a year, right? I mean, very regimented. And when Jesus was hanging on the cross, the gospel writer records that when he said, cried out, "It is finished," and he died, that the veil of the temple, that veil was the thing that separated man from the Holy of Holies, the presence of God. The gospel writer records the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. That was a 4-inch thick piece of tapestry that ripped from some unseen hand, amen, not so God, so you and I could come into God, but so God could come out and fellowship with us. To purchase this intimate fellowship. Glory to God. So when I preach like I did on New Year's Eve about the secret place, God's calling us back to the secret place. He's calling us back to a place of intimacy. And the thing that you and I avoid more than anything when we're in sin is intimacy. Okay, let me come where you live. You give your offspring, brother, sister, cousin, best friend, you loan them $100. And they're going to pay you Friday, and they don't pay you for 2 or 3 weeks. What happens? Suddenly they quit texting you. They don't return your calls. Why? Because they don't want to face up to you, right? and it's the same way. You know, I owe a debt I could not pay. Amen. He paid a debt he didn't owe. Amen. Thank God for that. He paid the price, and now He invites me to come in. Well, if I'm not cleansed from this, I'm going to have a real difficult time coming in and being intimate. My friend, let me tell you something. You need to practice intimacy with Father. You know, to just come. Look, he doesn't stand there with a big sledgehammer waiting to smash your head between your shoulders every time you blow it. Come on, like he's not playing whack-a-mole. You know, well, there's Pat again. Pow! Pat would come in here, knots all over his head. Sometimes he goes out that way after I preach at him so much. But amen. So he says, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all wickedness, unrighteousness. How many of you have experienced that? Oh, my word. To get up from an altar and not just feel forgiven, but to feel clean. As Brother Clint Nennan says, to be delivered from the vanity of wanting an airplane. Come on, to be delivered from the vanity of wanting things. That I don't want what I used to want. That only comes through the cleansing of the blood of Jesus. And folks, that doesn't come cheap. Amen. All right. So, that's my first point. What time is it? Hallelujah. We're looking good. Amen. So, it comes at a price, and that price was Jesus. Freedom is not free. Freedom must be maintained. Amen. Look at let's go to the second verse. They have to obey their guardians until they reach whatever age their father set. And that's the way it was with us before Christ came. We were like children. We were slaves to the basic spiritual principles. There's several translations use several different words here. I heard one guy preaching, and he said it's like karma, and I kind of like that little thought, train of thought he was on. That the basic principles of life that you obeyed before you came to Christ were like, you know, a black cat runs out in front of you and you're like, oh no. Or you don't go to work on Friday the 13th. Or, you know, help me. Give me some of these little wives' tales we wrestle with. Don't walk under a ladder. Broken mirrors. Yeah. Huh? Spilt salt. What are you, throw something over your shoulder? Yeah. Don't step on a crack on the sidewalk. Boy, so these sidewalks in town, you'd have trouble with that. Oh, yeah, got my lucky rabbit's foot. Yeah. These Super Bowl guys, they got certain underwear and socks they wear, right? Okay, all of these things are, you know, some of them have their roots in witchcraft, right? The salt thing, right? And some of this other stuff. Some of it, it's just old wives' tales. But it guides your life. And that's kind of the word that he's saying, these basic spiritual principles. But he's going back to the law, right? It's like we're, if I don't do this, and God's mad at me, right? Okay, Christian, how many of you feel that? If you don't do something just right, God's mad at you. Yeah. Most Christians, if you were honest, I could start naming the things, and you were like, oh, wow, that's true. Yeah. And Paul is trying to deliver this church from this mindset. That God's not looking for an excuse to send you to hell. That is a revelation to so many people. God is not looking for a reason to be mad at you. He put the penalty of your disobedience on his own son. Why would he do that? Why would he do that? To redeem you and I that were under the curse that came as a result of the law. The law is good, and it has its purpose to bring us to Christ. You got to know, folks, God is still against murder, right? For the American Evangelical Church, we've got to understand murder is abortion. Murder is hating someone because they're of a different race or ethnicity or... Come on. You cannot hate a brother you can't see and love a God you cannot see. That is a complete oxymoron when it comes to God. This doesn't work. And so you've got to understand God is after you to just take upon yourself his nature. That I love like he loves. And I hate the things he hates. God hates some things. He hates a proud look. Right out of the book of Proverbs. Come on, Proverbs says, six things the Lord hates, no seven are an abomination to him. He leads the list off with a proud look. Boy, there's a lot of Americans in trouble now, right? So we have to understand that in order to be able to grow to the place to where we become mature inheritors of what God has given us, amen. I'm Bill Gates. Wouldn't you love to be Bill Gates' kid, 12 years old, and he's dead, and you're just waiting to grow up and inherit all them billions of dollars? Number one, I wouldn't want to be his kid, but I could use some of that money. Be wonderful, wouldn't it? But you and I would be like, what have I got to do? What have I got to do to get the money? What do I got to do? Yeah, you know, yes, sir, no, sir. You know, stand up. Get up at 6 o'clock in the morning. You would regimen your life in order to position yourself. Come on, amen? But it's not like God is not looking for, you know, AI. Of course, artificial intelligence is exactly what it says. It's artificial. It's not intelligence. Anyway, he's not looking for a robot. He's looking for men and women who have his heart. So if I know, so I was talking to somebody at work the other day, and they're like, you know, man, I never smoked any marijuana when I was in school. I said, I never did as long as I was in my dad's house. I was a drunk. He was okay with drinking, and so I was a drunk by the time I was 13 years old. That wasn't no big deal. But I never, I would, at the bus stop, I would pass joints. Never smoked one. Why? Because I respected my dad. Come on. I knew dad would get kind of, he would get upset, you know, but he kind of secretly pat me on the back if I come home drunk. Come on, I wasn't raised in church. Come on, stay with me. There's a lot of folks out here like that. But if he ever saw me smoking a joint or whatever, it would crush him. And then he'd kill me. So I'd pass them joints at the bus stop. I never smoked marijuana because of the respect I had for my dad. He wasn't at the bus stop with me telling me, don't you do that. This is a love that I had for my father. Oh, come on, church. You know, God doesn't accept, he doesn't give you a list of do's and don'ts and demand you do this. He says, I want you to get so close to me that you understand my heart. And if you understand my heart, then you will live according, because I'm Abba. I'm not just the big man upstairs. I'm not God. I am your father. And I love you, and I want you to love me back. Come on, church. That is the mark of maturity. How does maturity come? It comes through discipleship. It comes from, you know, the younger listening to the elder. And the elder saying the right things. And sometimes age is not an indication of maturity. Let me get back up here. Amen. I've known some 50, 60-year-old men that never grew up. Come on. God's after something. He's after something a little deeper than that, right? So if we're gonna live free, and this whole chapter 4 and chapter 5, it's all about the freedom we have in Jesus. This is not freedom to do anything we want to do. This is freedom to live by the love relationship we have with our Creator, with the Father, with Abba, that I don't just know Him from a distance, but that I walk with Him. Man, the old church, we used to sing it, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I'm His own, and the joys we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Now, friend, just taking the clause of that song, none other has ever known. Do you have such a relationship with God that you could say nobody knows the relationship I have with God? Amen. I can say that about my wife. Amen. Nobody has ever loved me like that woman loves me. I can say that. Poor thing. She don't get out much. She doesn't know any better, right? But she has convinced me that there's not another human on planet Earth could ever love me like she does. I'm sold. I'm convinced of that. And what does that do? That makes me honor and value this and protect this relationship. Come on, guys. If I understand that God wants that same kind of relationship, this is discipleship, then I will maintain that thing. And when I feel any distance between me and Abba, I will, okay, Father, what have I done? Let me make this right, right? And so I confess my sin, not just to get forgiven, but wash that rebellious thing out of me. I don't want to be a rebel, amen, living in God's house. You know, the whole parable about the two sons, everybody says, oh, the prodigal son. Well, no, there's two sons. There's a son that never left the house that really wasn't living. And there's one that lived, left the house, but he was really the only one that knew the relationship that his father wanted. Which one are you? All right, we'll save that for another time. Amen. Let's go on down a little bit more. That was verse 3. Verse 4, but when the right time came, oh, somebody say, thank God He's always on time. Amen. When the right time came, God sent His Son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent Him to buy freedom for us who were slaves to the law, so that he could adopt us as his very own children. Amen. Oh, glory to God. We got to fight for that. We got to fight for that kind of freedom. Because the enemy is always looking at what is, you know, Jesus said, I came that you might have life. Satan's come to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you might have life and that more abundantly, right? So what is the devil? Oh, yeah, I believe he's trying to steal, kill, and destroy. What is he trying to steal, really? Faith, yeah. So what happened? What is this accuser going to get from you? He's going to get the same thing he got from Adam. When he caused Adam to sin, he got legal right to the things of this earth. Adam was the ruler. He was told to subdue the earth. This I give you authority and a charge to rule and govern the earth. And when he sinned, Satan obtained those rights to rule and to govern the earth. Now, when you and I come to in Christ, we get back what we lost in Adam. Come on, church. That's the word of God. Otherwise, quit coming up here and asking me to pray because you don't believe it. Amen. But I believe when I pray for people that are sick, I'm exercising the authority and the right that I have in Christ, amen, to govern this earth. Come on, you got to understand. That's how the healing anointing flows through us. Because we have now delegated authority through Christ. Amen. And so the enemy comes to try to move us off of that so that he can then get legal right to your life. And that's why, you know, 2024 is a season of war. We've got to understand there's some things we're going to have to fight for. I'm going to have to fight to stay. I've got to fight to stay free. Amen. Thank God I'm born again. But that, you know, I still got this skin. Amen. And this stuff is nasty. You don't believe that? Just skip. Don't take a bath for a few days. You may not be dead, but you stinketh. Right? Come on, guys. You know, kids are, that's what I love about children. Children are so honest. They are just, they're wonderful. Little girls, you know, you saw this little thing. She didn't think nothing. Come here, what's her name? Brynlyn. Come here to Pappy. I'm over there just worshiping. And she don't think nothing. Why are you crying? I didn't mean to make you cry, baby. I just wanted to hug you. Lord, she thinks I got on her case now. But I'm sitting there worshiping. All of a sudden, I feel something tugging. Like, she doesn't understand it's church. You can't do that in church. Well, she can. Come on. Pick up this little thing and love on her any chance I get. Why? That's what I want her to think about. Damn, I remember being in the house of God. And I felt such love and peace. There's nothing my pastor would withhold from me. And why is that important? Because she looks at me as God right now. She doesn't have the mental capacity to have a concept of who God is. And so by me picking her up and holding her and loving on her, she's learning what God wants. But kids are brutally honest. You know, this age, they'll tell you. I remember Bethany said it this way. Mommy, your air stinks. You know, they're not mean. Not saying anything mean. They're just telling it how it is. Your air stinks. She had this little speech thing. Right? I love kids. They're just honest. And they're open and they're free. Do you understand this is what God wants for me and you? That man, we just think it's just normal as breathing for us to come at any time of the day and climb up in Abba's lap and say, Daddy, I just need a hug. I just want to feel your presence. She never asked me for nothing a while ago. She just wanted to climb up in my arms and let me hold her. Never asked for nothing. Now, if it's my kids, they'd have, you got any candy? Right? Yeah, my kids are always, they hadn't changed. They're 30, 40 years old. Now, you got any money? They hadn't changed at all. But the relationship that we've developed through the years gives them the freedom to ask and not feel like they've got to jump through hoops before they do. You okay, baby girl? I didn't mean to make you cry. I guess she thought she was in trouble. You wasn't in trouble. Pappy wanted to hold you and use you as an illustration. Explain that to her one day. But folks, we've got to fight to maintain that kind of a relationship with God. Because everything, the world, the devil, the church sometimes, tries to put God off at a distance. And God forbid you ever blow it. Man, I worked in this job one time. Now, you got to understand, I've mellowed in my old age. I mean, I'm closer to 70 than I am to 60. I like saying it that way. That sounds pretty cool. And, you know, but when I was a young man, I was mouthy. Now, I know it's hard for y'all to believe that. But I'd witness to a fence post, man, if it stands still long enough, right? And so, you know, everybody know me. Me and this other guy, a friend of mine, a buddy of mine, Leonard Schofield, we're the preachers on the job. There's 50 of us millwrights in this big plant, covered 400 acres. And, man, we witnessing everybody in that plant. And of course, I'm just, you know, what you see is what you get. I love life, and I like to have fun. And I'm out there, we're laughing and cutting up, and I don't know what I was doing. I was making noise with the hammer, beating on the table. I was doing something still. And this big old guy, he's like, I thought you was a Christian. Yeah, I'm a Christian. What's your problem? Well, you're over here laughing and hollering and making all that noise. Yeah. Tell me more. You know, it's like, what? He was dead serious. He was furious that I'm over there as a believer, enjoying life, cutting up with my buddies, and having fun. Right? And I'm like, and I said, so, well, he said, I'm a Christian, and I don't act that way. I'm like, yeah, you don't. I hear you cussing and telling dirty jokes and, hello? Now, he's having an affair with his wife, you know, and he's a deacon in a Baptist church somewhere. What do you think that was? He saw the freedom and the joy that I had, just like this one. No inhibitions. I'm just going to love being with Jesus. I'm living large and loving life. Everybody knows that's my saying. What? I got two things. If they'll ask me in the morning, how are you? I got one or two things I say. I'm living large and loving life, or I say, I'm peachy. It's all good. Listen, if you're a Christian and you go to work all sad and in the mully grubs, do me a favor. Keep your faith to yourself. It's bad advertisement. Come on. The Lord doesn't need any more of that kind of PR, right? Amen. He needs people that have maintained their freedom in Christ. But the minute you start acting on that freedom, man, glory to God, I've got joy unspeakable and full of glory. It really freaks me out when people from work and people I've worked with, you know, around the country, right? So it's like, you know, for the last several weeks, I've got an electrician from Louisiana, up in New Orleans. Man, he's watching us every Sunday, and he's tagging people, saying, man, come on in here, watch this. I'm like, dude, check this out. It's like, you know, I'm glad I wasn't out there with him cussing and hollering and telling dirty stories and then getting up here and preaching to you folks. I don't have to be embarrassed that people that know me will watch me in church. Come on. I got people say, you know, man, I don't go to the altar because I don't want to be on TV. Okay, let me get back to my notes. Hello? All right. Get to the word. We'll wrap this up here. So it's got to be fought for. This freedom must be fought to maintain it. Verse 6, because we are His children, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, prompting us to call Abba. Folks, I hear, and expositors different, differ on really what Paul is talking about, but I think he's talking about the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Amen. You know, because I was, you know, I was pretty, and even after I got filled with the Holy Ghost, I was still pretty, you know, you probably wasn't, you're not going to heaven, and I'm kind of iffy, right? I mean, everybody's going to hell. I was just a fire breather, right? Because it was all about what I, even though I wasn't a law follower, Christianity became my law. And if you didn't live for God like I lived for God, then you was in trouble. Come on. And some of that's good. I needed to be strong like that because I had a lot of stuff to correct in my own life. I've told some people, that this one person asked me, said, Pastor, I'm losing a lot of friends for, you know, the stands I'm taking. Am I wrong? I'm like, how am I going to address this? I said, no, you need to keep doing what you're doing because I know what your past is. You need to be strong. Some of you need to be ruthless with yourself. Come on. You need to beat that body into subjection. Amen. And then in time, the Holy Ghost will come in and pour in that love. Right? And when you take a life of holiness and you mix it with the love of God, there comes this purity. Amen. Holiness alone, amen, right living alone becomes mean. Any of y'all ever known anybody's just mean? Oh, yeah. I'm talking Christians now. People in the church, they're just mean. Yeah. I just love Jesus. I'm like, would you tell your face that? Right? You know, some folks are just mean. But you take that desire for holiness and right living, and you mix in the love and the grace of God, and you have this beautiful, powerful message of the cross. Now, it was this very verse, and I would have to go back to the ESV, and I left that at home, my other translation. But it's these very verses that started the Martin Luther, Reformation, that started the Reformation, that the just will live by faith. And that folks, we understand that if we're going to be just in the eyes of God, it's not because of what we do. It's because we have allowed our faith to reach up to heaven, to bring us into this relationship where we can cry, Abba, Father. The just live by faith. And as I'm living by faith, I look back over my life and I'm like, wow, I have fulfilled the law. Do you see the difference? That it's not a list of do's and don'ts. It is a come unto me. Let's develop this relationship. And as I walk with God, and that's where he's going to go in chapter 5. For as I walk with God, amen, walking in the Spirit, I look back over my shoulder and I'm like, oh my goodness. You know, I never knew this walk would have become what it is. I started this journey 45 years ago, a confused 20-year-old young man. I love Pat's phrase. Confused as a termite in a yo-yo. Didn't know which end was up. Amen. But I just knew that the call of God to salvation was as real as anything I had ever experienced in my life. And I'm like, I've tried all of this, and I don't like what I've experienced. So I'm going to try Jesus. It's not like I put him on trial, but I'm like, I'm going to give my life to this Christ. Now, folks, I'm telling you, this is the kind of relationship you want to have. This is the kind of relationship you want your children to have and your children's children to have. Not one where you know, somebody's always got to be beating on them, telling them what to do. But you just get them connected to Christ, get them full of the Holy Ghost, and you know that their walk will lead them in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Amen. He sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, prompting us to call out, Abba. Just like little Brendan. Did she run off? I scared her that bad. Okay, leave her there. I'll leave her alone. Don't want her to cry no more. Last verse here tonight. Now, somebody say now. You are no longer a slave. Well, boy, if we was Pentecostals, I'd have to tell you, sit down, it's okay. Sit down, let me finish this. Some of you ought to be excited about that. Let me tell you something. If you've ever been a slave and you read that, you're going to shout. Come on. Come on. I'm no longer a slave to sin, to fear, to anxiety. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Amen. I love that chorus. And every time I sing it these days, I hear Scott Coon. when he first came here, he introduced me to that song, actually, I think. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Friend, I want you to understand tonight, I want you to understand your freedom is based upon your relationship to Father God through Christ. And the Holy Spirit is calling you into this intimate relationship with Him so that through that relationship, life can manifest. Amen. You're no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you are His child, God has made you what? His heir. The Lord gave me a phrase several years ago talking about my kid, that my children are the beneficiaries. They're reaping the benefits of my obedience to God. Amen? Sometimes that's what keeps me on the straight and narrow, knowing the effect that it would have on my children. And so when my kids would get a little out of line, I remind God, Abba, me and you got a thing going on here. And my kids are going to be the benefit, the recipients of the benefit of my obedience. So I walk in faith. Amen. Come on, church. I'm no longer. So God has made you His heir. What have you received as an heir of God? Freedom. Life everlasting. Being intimate, yes, yes, intimacy. Amen. What? Yeah. Becomes a suggestion. Right? The authority, yeah. Old singing. We'd sing it at the convention every year. So many lives depend. I'm going on. I'm going on. I'm going on toward the mark, toward my goal. So many lives depend on what I do. Lord, give me the strength. I'm going on for You. I'm an heir of God. I've received some things. What have I received? Well, first of all, I've received freedom from the fear of the future. Come on. You know, it's like, you know, people, I meet Christians that are scared to death, you know, of dying. It's like, what are you scared of? What you going to do, threaten me with heaven? Come on. I'm kind of excited. Now, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die to get there. Right? And I don't mind dying. I just got a few ways I don't want to die. Right? But let me tell you. It doesn't matter how you die. It's only for an instant. Amen. And, you know, whatever you got to go through. Now, I will say, you know, you see the pictures of these folks in Nigeria. And I was going to mention that as we close in prayer tonight. We need to pray for the persecuted church in Nigeria, how they're killing them for sport over there, Christians. The Muslims are just slaughtering Christians over there. But I've said this before. If you ever see a video of me on my knees and just you know, calmly giving them my neck, letting them cut my head off, one of two things has happened. Number one, there has been a supernatural anointing. The martyr's gift has baptized me, and I know that, and I'll just do it, yeah. Or they have drugged me out of my mind. One of them two things. If barring either one of those, I will be kicking, biting, scratching. If they knock all my teeth out, I'll gum them to death. But I'm telling you, you ain't cutting my head off. Not me, just not me being passive. That ain't going to happen. I'm going to fight you every step of the way. Some freedom's got to be fought for, right? But when we look at it in the grand scope of things, friends, As a follower of Jesus Christ, this life is a vapor. Amen. It's boom, it's gone. I mean, I look back, we just started dating. A little 15-year-old girl I took out to the rodeo one night. It seemed like yesterday. And here we are, we're 85 years? How long have we been married since? I'm sorry, 45 years. Amen. Just kidding, babe. Seems like yesterday. Amen. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Amen. I want you to live every day like you have an audience with the King every morning when you wake up. And right now, I want you just to stand to your feet. And let's go to God, not like the big man upstairs, but like He's my Abba. Amen? Abba, Father. Abba, Father. Hallelujah. Lord, we love You so much. I thank You for the revelation of Your Word that shows us what kind of freedom we have. Lord, we're not free from the consequences of this stuff. Lord, if we sin, there is a penalty, Lord, in the flesh that's going to be paid. But Lord, I thank You that through the blood of Jesus, we can have true freedom. We can be free from fear, free from anxiety, free from it all, and just know that we are loved by You. I pray that in this house and those watching online, Lord, that men and women will experience Your love. And that Lord, we'll hear Your voice calling us, Abba. Come on, my son. Come on, my daughter. Let me hold you. Let me love you. Let me speak life. Let me pour in the oil and the wine and bring healing and refreshing to your soul. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Nobody looking around. I just, as I started praying, I'm just sensing just the prophetic anointing. God wants, He wants to pour in that healing oil into your life. Some of you here tonight, you're going through a really rough time, and it's been nothing but bitterness and confusion and strife. And right now, the Holy Spirit is releasing His peace. And you can have this confident assurance of God's love and His presence in the middle of the storm. Jesus was in the boat in the storm, and He was asleep. The storm was on the outside. It never got on the inside. And friend, tonight I want to tell you the chaos that might surround you cannot disturb your peace when your life is hidden with Christ in God. So I want to speak peace over you right now in Jesus' name. Come on. Come on. Peace, 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 peace. Thank You, Father. Thank You, Father. Thank You, Lord. If that's you, just lift your hand and say, Pastor, I need that. Thank You. Thank You. Yeah, yeah. All in this room. Thank You, man. Hallelujah. Yeah. I knew that was the Holy Ghost. Shadabaroso tororoboshar. Come on. Come on. Guys, put some pads or whatever on. Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus, I speak peace. Peace right now, Lord, to the confusion. And everywhere the enemy is trying to move us off of where you have placed us, where You have called us. Trying to get us to sell our birthright for a pot of red beans. God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that men and women will stand, that they will fight for their freedom. They will fight for the peace of God. And let Your peace, Father, be the governor in their heart. And right now, just if that's you, I just want you just to lift your hands. And I want you to receive the peace of God. Peace, peace, peace. Come on. Shataramaro sotoro shenegia. Rasatarabarondo shoroboto yesene. Jesus, Jesus. I want you to do like little Brindlin right now. I just want you to climb up in Abba's arms and let Him hold you. Let Him put His arm around you. You're too manly for that. Let Him put His arm around you. pat you on the back and tell you, son, this is going to be all right. I'm going to take care of this. I've got you. I've got you. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you here tonight need to listen to his voice where he's saying, son, listen to me. I'm going to give you direction. I'm going to show you how to get out of this. But you've got to listen and follow my instructions and not ever go back. Because I've called you out of this pig pen once. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's no weapon formed against you that can prosper. Come on, just let him. There's a work of the Spirit going on right now. Just let him. Some of you, you just need to let him pray through you. Some of you, you've got the direction, and he's just waiting on you to open your mouth, begin to command. Amen. You need to fight. How do you fight? You fight in prayer. You begin to come against that thing in Jesus' name. Father God, I come against the attack upon my children in the mighty name of Jesus, and I will not allow the enemy to come in and destroy families. In Jesus' name, I bind a spirit of rebellion on the children. In the name of Jesus, come on. I come against the enemy trying to destroy my family. Lord, I don't have the answers, but my eyes are on you. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Lord, I pray that you heal the wandering heart. That, Lord, that brother, that sister would find the place in you where they can feel accepted and loved, and they'll quit wandering around looking for acceptance and love from other places. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, and yes, that was for you. Jesus. Man. Holy Ghost will get right up in your business if you let him. Amen. I want to tell you, there is that the greatest thing I've ever found in my life is this walk with Christ. I've got a wonderful wife. I've got wonderful children. But there ain't nothing better than Jesus. I said there's nothing better than my Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. All right. Primetimers Thursday night. Oh, that's tomorrow night. That's the first Thursday of this week. I said of this week. See, y'all not listening. Y'all want to correct Pastor. You're not listening. Tomorrow night, primetimers. And Sunday morning, we'll be here for church. The family La Mesa will be preaching the gospel. Amen. I love you. I pray God's richest blessing on your life. Be dismissed. Get out of here.